Hello again and a very warm welcome to Sunday Thoughts from Ardtrea and Desertcreat. I hope you're all keeping okay. Thank you for taking time to join us for a little while this morning. There's just one announcement today, and that is to remind you that during the months of July and August, we're doing our summer timetable thing here in our churches. That means there's only one service each week and it will be at 10:30. And the idea is, of course, it gets you out early. If you want to come to church, you can be gone early to spend roasting days by the sea on the beach. That's the plan anyway, for what it's worth. So the way we're doing it is the first Sunday in July, Sunday the 4th, we're only in Ardtrea. The second Sunday in July, Sunday the 11th, we're only in Desertcreat. The third Sunday in July, Sunday the 18th, we're back in Ardtrea. And the fourth Sunday in July, we're in Desertcreat. And then we repeat that pattern in August. So there's only one service each Sunday. And don't forget, it will be at 10:30 to let you away early. Also, just keep in mind, we're hoping to have the Archbishop with us, John McDowell, God willing, on the 11th of July in Desertcreat. He's out and about at long last after the whole lockdown thing, just trying to get to know his way around the diocese. So we're looking forward to inviting him along. I've told him it'll be quiet on the 11th of July because most people are on holiday. But as far as I know, he's still planning to join us. Now, this morning we're going to start our Sunday Thoughts with a little floral colour video. I've been collecting your flower pictures and we're going to show those in a few weeks. But today I want to show you some snaps I took just last week. My friend Dorothy up at Lisna Hall invited me to come and see the colours in her front garden. And I've been admiring the colours in her front garden every year for 20 years, you know. So I headed up to Lisna Hall and took some snaps. And Dorothy pointed out a little strip of ground the locals just call the council strip. And some of the residents plant poppies and wildflowers and tend this lovely strip of ground with green fields behind it. And so I'm bringing you some floral colour today, courtesy of the good people of Lisna Hall. I particularly was drawn to the poppies, the Flanders field kind of poppies, and found them for me a poignant reminder that the anniversary of the Battle of the Somme was just a few days away. So here's some colour, just a minute and a bit, from the good people of Lisna Hall. Hope you enjoy it. Today is read to us by Cherith, and it's the story of two healings, one visible and one invisible. Here's the reading.
The reading is from Mark chapter 5, verses 21 to 43. When Jesus had again crossed over by boat to the other side of the lake, a large crowd gathered round him while he was by the lake. Then one of the synagogue rulers named Jairus came there. Seeing Jesus, he fell at his feet and pleaded earnestly with him, "My little daughter is dying. Please come and put your hands on her so that she will be healed and live." So Jesus went with him. A large crowd followed and pressed around him. and a woman who was there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years. She had suffered a great deal under the care of many doctors and had spent all she had, yet instead of getting better, she grew worse. When she heard about Jesus, she came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak, because she thought, "If I touch his clothes, I will be healed." Immediately her bleeding stopped, and she felt in her body that she was freed from her suffering. At once Jesus realized that power had gone out of him. He turned around in the crowd and asked, "Who touched my clothes?" "You see the people crowding against you," his disciples answered, "and yet you can ask, 'Who touched me?'" But Jesus kept looking around to see who had done it. Then the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came and fell at his feet, and trembling with fear, told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace and be freed from your suffering." While Jesus was still speaking, some men came from the house of Jairus, the synagogue ruler. "Your daughter is dead," they said. "Why bother the teacher anymore?" Ignoring what they had said, Jesus told the synagogue ruler, "Don't be afraid, just believe." He did not let anyone follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they came to the home of the synagogue ruler, Jesus saw a commotion with people crying and wailing loudly. He went in and said to them, "Why all this commotion and wailing? The child is not dead, but asleep." But they laughed at him. After he put them all out, he took the child's father and mother and the disciples who were with him, and they went where the child was. He took her by the hand and said to her, "Talitha, come," which means, "Little girl, I say to you, get up." Immediately the girl stood up and walked around. She was 12 years old. At this they were completely astonished. He gave strict orders not to let anyone know about this, and he told them to give her something to eat. This is the word of the Lord.
This morning's story follows on from last week's story. Just in case you missed last week, let me recap. We were thinking about the really well-known story of the calming of the storm. And we thought about the word fear and how it cropped up twice in the story. Once when the disciples had a fear that they were going to die. And secondly, when they had this mixture of fear and awe in the presence of one who had the ability to just speak a word and calm a storm. In this morning's story then, we're thinking of what happens when the little boat arrives at the other side of the lake. And Jesus is going to calm a few more storms. Only this time, instead of being a storm at sea, he's going to calm storms in people's lives. Now, I think the main point from today's Bible reading is this, that Jesus was never too busy for people in need. I mean, he was often busy. He never seemed to be hurried, but he always had time for people in need. Now, these stories are found in three Gospels. They're found in Matthew and Mark and Luke. And the writers tell of two miracles that they tie together. And they're quite different in that one was a very visible healing, the raising of Jairus' daughter. And the other was an invisible healing, the healing of a lady who had some kind of a gynae issue that had been causing her to bleed. And as you know, you probably know the story, she sneaks up to Jesus in a crowd and she touches the hem of his coat. But the story begins with this man called Jairus falling at the feet of Jesus and asking him to help because his daughter, who was only 12 years old, was apparently dying. Now, sometimes the gospel stories, the writers of the stories tell the details differently. For example, one version of the story says that whenever Jairus came to Jesus, his daughter was dying. Yet another gospel says when he came to Jesus, his daughter had already died. Regardless, Jairus was an important man. He was one of the rulers in the synagogue. That meant he would have been responsible for organising things like worship rotas, you know, who would read, who would speak at meetings, those kind of things. He was a Jewish religious leader. And somewhere along the line, he had heard about this man, Jesus, and his ability to heal. And he wondered if Jesus could help his little daughter, who clearly was very sick and only 12 years old. Now, Jesus is really keen to help, and he's making his way through crowds to get to the house of Jairus. This is a medical emergency. This is life or death. But something unexpected happens in the middle of his journey. In the middle of the crowd, there's this poor lady who's had the same problem for years. It was a condition that caused her to bleed, some kind of a gynae condition, and she'd suffered for 12 years and desperately wanted help. Now, the thing about her condition was that, number one, it had pretty severe physical consequences. It was painful and it was a difficult thing to live with. But as well as that, her condition, believe it or not, also had social consequences. In biblical times, in the times of the New Testament, if word got out that a woman had this kind of an issue, she was considered not just sick, but also in some way ceremoniously or religiously unclean. And so people would have kept her at a distance. I mean, she wouldn't have been invited to weddings or parties or girls' nights out, that kind of thing. People, you know, it was a bit like having leprosy. She would have been kept at a distance. So it was awful. And it was a terrible thing because people who had sore feet weren't treated like that. Or people who had a bad back weren't treated like that. But this particular condition had social consequences as well. In those days, a lot of Jewish men wore blue tassels on their coats, apparently. 10 of them as a reminder of the commandments that God gave to Moses. Now, this lady would have maybe been too embarrassed to go directly to Jesus and tell him what was wrong. But something in her sensed that maybe if she could just literally touch his coat or one of the tassels on his coat, that might be enough to get some level of healing. She makes her way through the crowd, reaches out maybe just for one of the tassels on Jesus' coat, and something really amazing happens. She is healed instantly and invisibly. I find it quite funny that Matthew and Mark point out that she had spent all her money on doctors, and if anything was worse than ever. Luke, who was a doctor, interestingly, leaves out that little detail in his version of the story. Jesus knew that power had left him, and he asks the question, "Who touched me?" Which at first reading seems like a bit of a silly question in a way, because he's in the middle of a crowd of people. Loads of people are touching him. People are rubbing against each other. And he's trying to make his way through to the house of Jairus to heal a sick girl. But he sensed that something had changed, and he knew that someone had deliberately touched him. The poor woman makes her way nervously through the crowd, and she owns up. She said, "It was me. I touched you." And I'm sure at this point she's wondering, is Jesus going to be mad at me? Am I going to get sick again? Have I made a terrible mistake in trying to do this? But Jesus, I think, wanted her to know a few things that were going to be really important. You see, it would have been really easy for the lady to sneak away knowing that she had been healed. But her illness was invisible to most people, so there was no real proof that she had been healed. But in making her go public, Jesus was showing the woman and also her friends in the crowd that she was healed. And that meant that her friends would know she could be accepted into everyday public life again. You know, she would get invitations to the weddings and the parties and whatever else they did. She was content with just being healthy, but Jesus wanted to give her more. He wanted to give her life back again because he cared for her and he knew that this was an issue with her particular illness. Now, he also wanted her to know, I think, that there was nothing magical about his coat. It was the power of God that made her well, and faith was involved. Now, meanwhile, back at Jairus' house, there was big trouble. Can you imagine how Jairus felt with a dead or dying daughter, and this lady comes along and interrupts Jesus, holds the whole thing up? Jairus would have been tearing his hair out. The story of Jairus' daughter, of course, has a happy ending, and we'll keep that story for another day. But here are just a few important things we can learn from the story of the healing of the lady who reached out and touched Jesus' coat. If we ever feel that no one has time for us, never forget that God always has time for you. Even in the middle of this busy schedule, even in the middle of a medical emergency, a life and death situation. Jesus had time for this woman who needed help. And he went beyond just healing her physically, as I pointed out. He actually gave her her social life back again. I suppose we need to ask ourselves the question, do we have time for those around us who are suffering and who are in need? The bereaved or the sick or the downhearted or the discouraged? I think maybe often we are part of the answer to our own prayers, you know. I have at home here several collections of prayers that I use now and again for leading prayers in public worship. And one prayer finishes with the words, Lord, the things we have prayed for, give us also the grace to work for. We have to recognise that sometimes we're part of the answer to our own prayers. So as well as praying for the bereaved and the sick and the discouraged, it's really important that we call them, text them, visit when we can, when it's safe to do so. It's really important to have time for people in need, as Jesus did. Jesus, who calmed the storm on the seas, also had time to calm storms in people's lives, bringing healing mentally and physically, bringing wholeness and brand new starts. Let's pray together. Lord, in our prayers this morning, we pray for those who are sick. We pray for those in hospital. We remember our health service workers. And as we remember those who are sick, we also give you thanks for those who have been made well and who've recovered from illness. We pray for one another as we enter another week. We pray for those who are looking forward to some holiday time off or time away. We pray that whatever we're up to this week, that we will know your blessing, the blessing of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thanks for listening. Here's some closing music from New Mills Silver Band.